To see y'all this morning. We're so glad you're here to worship with us today. It's almost Christmas, right? 1 week from today. We're so thankful that you're here. Today is part three of our Call of Christmas series, so we're excited that you are here for that with us. And we're going to begin together first as we sing in worship of our Lord today. Let's stand together as we sing. This the first Noel.
The first Noel, the angels did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold.
Christmas. So good to see you this morning. We're glad you're here and glad for those that are joining us online this morning. Hope you're having a great holiday so far. Remember, we're all about thinking about Jesus, celebrating what he's done for us in his coming to earth so we can know him as our Lord and Savior. That's what Christmas is about. And as long as we keep focused on the true meaning of Christmas, that is in Christ, it directs everything we do. And so we're glad that you're here this morning to worship, and we ask that everybody fill out the information card that is in your bulletin. If you have not already done that, at some point in the service, fill that out, and then when you leave, just drop it in the offering drop boxes at the back. We're so glad you're here. We're going to have a great time this morning celebrating Jesus Christ and studying his word together. We're glad you're here. Let me lead us in prayer this morning. Oh, Father God, as we come before you, we come thanking you that you are Emmanuel, God with us. We thank you that you're here today. You speak to our hearts. You work in our lives. You're receiving our worship unto you, Father God, and we just praise you. We worship you this morning. I thank you for the, each one that are here. I thank you that we can come before you. We can be honest with you, and you work in our hearts. You mold us, shape us, you draw us to you so we can experience the goodness and the greatness, the redeeming, the refreshing, the renewing work that is found in the Savior, Christ the Lord. We celebrate you not only today, not only this week, but all year through and for eternity because of who you are and what you've done. It's in that wonderful name of Christ we pray. Amen. Let's continue as we worship.
Yeah.
words of that song be the meditations of our heart. Amen. To come and adore Christ Jesus, our Lord. He is worthy of our praise. We're going to continue to praise him this morning as we sing together.
In excelsis Dei.
praise you indeed. Give thanks. Glory is to your name. Father, we thank you that you chose, Father, to first love us when we had not a thought of you in our sin. And Father, you chose to send your Son to be the ultimate gift to tell the greatest story ever told in the birth of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and what he would come to do through the cross and his resurrection. But Father, it started that Christmas night. We give you thanks. It's in your precious holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
I'd like to read our scripture from Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. Matthew 1, beginning in verse 18. Listen as I read this important passage of scripture. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will be with child and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
There were 14 generations between Father Abraham and King David. 14 more generations between David and the Babylonian exile. And 14 generations later, the great king would be born. A 2,000-year lineage comprised of slaves and kings, heroes and adulterers, prophets and prostitutes. They were the faithful and the faithless. So what kind of king would this be? While many dreamed of the day this king would come, it began as a real-life nightmare for one man. A good man, God's lot cast upon him.
Joseph. Joseph. I promise you, Joseph, I am telling you the truth.
I'm not saying you don't believe it. I'm just saying, I don't know if I do.
So, what are you saying?
Take her as your wife. Take her as your wife. But she's pregnant! I haven't been with her! The baby's not mine!
Take Mary as your wife.
I can't do this! I don't want to hurt her. But I can't. I'll divorce her.
Joseph, you are a descendant of David.
Your ancestors have taken great steps of faith, and now it is time for you to step out. Take Mary as your wife.
But the baby is...
What is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. It is prophecy fulfilled. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
God with us.
God with us. Emmanuel.
Messiah.
A dream. A heavenly visitation. And what was distressing became a blessing. A blessing that would challenge Joseph's faith, demand every ounce of his character, and forever alter the course of his life. And yours.
God with us.
Those who study sleep patterns tell us that the average person has anywhere from 4 to 6 dreams every night, and that these dreams will last anywhere from 5 minutes to 20 minutes. Some dreams we don't even remember, but other dreams we remember, and sometimes very vividly. I wonder how many of you have dreams. How many of you have repeated dreams, which is kind of the same dream over and over again? A few people. I have a dream that I have quite often. I'm not sure exactly what it means. I have an idea, but I dream repeatedly that it's time for me to preach, and I'm trying to get up here to preach, but I can't. Something's hindering me. Sometimes it's I can't get out of the chair for some reason. Sometimes people are talking to me, and I'm trying to get up to preach, and sometimes I'm trying to get finished dressed, and I can't get my shoes on. I can't get them to fit or whatever, but I just can't get here to preach, and I'm supposed to be doing that, and I wake up all flustered and nervous and everything, thinking I need to be preaching, and I can't get there. But there's a lot of dreams that people have. Well, in the Bible, it talks about dreams a lot. In fact, there are over 100 references to dreams in the Bible. And many of those dreams in the Bible have to do with God communicating to people. All through history, there have been people who have referenced dreams, sometimes very vivid dreams. And in fact, today, you can read a lot that appears to be happening today in regards to dreams. There are a lot of reports to dreams appearing particularly to Muslim people about Jesus, the Savior, and the Redeemer. So we see a lot of activity about dreams throughout history. And in the passages of Scripture that we read, we see that God spoke to a man named Joseph in a dream. And in that dream, an angel appeared to Joseph concerning the call of Christmas that was coming to Joseph. But before I talk to you about what this call involved, let me just kind of set the stage. Most of you kind of know it, but to set the stage of what was happening in Joseph's life when he had this dream where an angel came to him in the dream. You remember Mary and Joseph were engaged to be married. They were betrothed. And this marriage, most likely, as it was common in the day, was arranged by Mary and Joseph's parents. They had come to an agreement of their marriage, and the marriage agreement was a kind of a legal agreement where things were stipulated in the agreement concerning the marriage. And for a year, they would be engaged. And this engagement period was very, very serious in that day. In fact, it was often pretty much like they were considered husband and wife during this engagement period. In many ways, they were thought of as husband and wife, but in other ways, they were not. Because at the end of this year period, there would be a ceremony, a marriage ceremony, and then and only then would the marriage be consummated by sexual relations. The engagement period was so serious that if one of the parties engaged in sexual relations before the completion of their marriage, it was considered adultery. And it was punishable possibly by stoning. So it was a very, very serious thing. It was during this time of engagement that, as we looked at last week, and in Luke tells us that Mary had a visit from an angel. And the angel told her that she was about to conceive and she would give birth to a son. And Mary, you remember, said, "How can this be? I'm a virgin. I've never been with a man." And the angel told her that what would be conceived in her would be conceived of the Holy Spirit. It would be a God thing within her. And Mary, in that incredible passage, speaking of her great faith and trust in God, said, "May it be done to me just as you've spoken." In other words, may God's will be done in my life. She didn't know a lot of the answers, a lot of the questions, but she trusted what God told her through the angel. And then we're told in Luke that Mary got ready and she hurried off to a little town where Elizabeth and Zechariah lived. They were kinfolk. And you remember a couple of weeks ago we talked about Zechariah and Elizabeth, how an angel had appeared to Zechariah and told Zechariah that there would be another miracle birth with he and Elizabeth. That Elizabeth, even though she was barren, even though she was old in age, she would become pregnant and she would give birth to a son. He would be John, and he would be the forerunner to the Messiah. And so she stays there for a while with Elizabeth and Zechariah. And as the days pass, it becomes obvious to everyone, not just to Zechariah and Elizabeth, but it becomes obvious to everyone that Mary is pregnant. Now, we're not told at what point that Mary went back to Nazareth, to where Joseph was. But it's obvious that it becomes so obvious that Mary's pregnant that Joseph finds out. Maybe she sends him word, or maybe the word just spreads through the grapevine as people begin to talk and people begin to whisper concerning Mary being pregnant. And obviously, Joseph's upset. I mean, can you just imagine some of the things Joseph is feeling, some of the emotions that are going through the depths of his being? He knows this child is not his. He wonders how Mary could commit adultery, how she could do this, how she could break his heart and violate the covenant. And so Joseph begins to weigh his options. He considers whether just to marry her, but he doesn't think that's a very good option, knowing that she apparently had committed adultery. And then he thinks about divorcing her, making a public spectacle of her, but he doesn't want to do that because he cares very much for her. And then he thinks about the possibility of divorcing her quietly, putting her away so it would not open her to as much public ridicule and maybe also protect her from stoning. And while he's thinking about these things, one night he lays down to sleep. And while he sleeps, he has a dream. And in the dream, an angel comes to him and says, "Joseph, you don't know everything that's going on with Mary. Let me tell you." what is conceived in her is conceived of the Holy Spirit. This is a God thing. Do not be afraid to take Mary home to be your wife. He rises from his sleep. He obeys what the angel told him. He takes Mary to be his wife, and Mary and Joseph walk into Christmas. That is the call of Christmas that came to Joseph. And it was a call to protect. Now, put on your outline several ways in which the call of Christmas to protect came to Joseph. First of all, Joseph was to protect himself from runaway emotions. He was to protect himself from runaway emotions. Again, Matthew 1, verse 20 said, after he had considered this, in other words, just putting Mary away and divorcing her quietly, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is conceived of the Holy Spirit. The angel said, don't be afraid. Now, we've already talked about an angel visiting some of the others in the call to Christmas. And each time the angel showed up, the angel said, don't be afraid. And sometimes it appears that the reason the angel told them not to be afraid, because when an angel showed up, there was generally reason to be afraid. I mean, you just think, if an angel showed up, and you knew it was an angel, a visitation from God with a word from God, something dramatic was about to take place in your life. And so the angel would say, do not be afraid, fear not. But this angel tells Joseph why he should not be afraid. He said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. Now, he had many emotions, many fears about him, but he said, don't be afraid. Do what I'm telling you. This is a message from God. Take Mary as your wife. And, you know, God knows us most. He knows what we're struggling with, what we're dealing with. And God knew that Joseph was on the verge of having runaway emotions, as could be expected. And many times, our emotions will prevent us from responding obediently to what God is wanting us to do. Just like if this emotion of fear, of doubt, of jealousy, or whatever else may have been going through Joseph's mind, had it allowed just to go rampant, he wouldn't have answered the call of Christmas that the angel made to him. So he was called to protect his runaway emotions when the angel said, do not be afraid. And then secondly, Joseph was called to protect Mary. He was called to protect Mary. He said, the angel said, Joseph, take Mary to be your wife. This was a call to protect. By taking Mary home as wife, it would protect her. It would protect her from much of the ridicule. It would protect her from much of the accusations. It very possibly was for protecting her from stoning, but it also would protect her from raising a child, a son, as a single parent. So it was a call that the angel gave to her to protect Mary. And then number three, Joseph was to protect Jesus. Now you may think, well, I don't think Jesus needed any protection. He's the Son of God. God the Father will protect Jesus. But yes, you know, in a very practical sense, God does his work through us, through people. And we've seen that already in this series, how God works through people to accomplish his purpose. And as Jesus was being born as a baby, as a child, being brought into this household, as Jesus took on flesh and became a babe, there was a call to protect him that Joseph received. And there are, of course, many obvious ways that parents are called to protect their children. We're to protect them by providing shelter. We're to protect them by providing food and clothing. But think of some of the ways, as we see this Christmas story unfold, that Joseph was called to protect Jesus. Number one, on the inside of your outline, he was called to protect Jesus' divinity. He was called to protect Jesus' divinity. Divinity refers to the divine nature, that Jesus is God, he is divine. And when I say he was called to protect the divinity of Jesus, you say, well, how can Joseph protect the godness of Jesus? Well, it's not that he was keeping Jesus from losing his godness or making sure he had it, but in a very practical sense, by what Joseph did, he protected Jesus, that he was and is the Son of God. You notice what it said there in Matthew 1:25? But Joseph did not consummate their marriage, this is after the angel told him what was going on, until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. In other words, Joseph didn't want there to be any question, any doubt about this child, the nature of this child, that this child was the Son of God, that this child was not his by natural birth, but this child was the Son of God. So he was called to protect the divinity, the godness of who Jesus was. And then secondly, Joseph was called to protect Jesus' safety, his safety. Now again, you think, Jesus doesn't need to be protected by Joseph, does he? I mean, he's God. He can protect himself. Remember, again, he's come to earth as a man. He has a babe. He's living under the care of Joseph and Mary. And he's called to protect Jesus because, as you remember, there were those that wanted to kill Jesus and to destroy him. We're told in Matthew chapter 2 that, remember, after Jesus' birth, there were many that came to worship Jesus, including the Magi. And they went to Herod and asked, you know, where is this one that is born King of the Jews? And old Herod, he had plans to kill Jesus because he didn't want any rival, any king that would rival him. And so the scripture in Matthew 2, verse 13 says, when they had gone, the wise men had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, get up. He said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. So Joseph got up, he took the child and his mother during the night, and they left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so was fulfilled what the Lord said through the prophet, out of Egypt I call my son. See, God warned Joseph again and said, Herod is wanting to kill Jesus. You're called to protect him, to humanly protect him. I'll work through you, so I'm giving you the warning. Take Mary and Joseph, y'all go to Egypt until Herod dies. And that's exactly what Joseph did. There was a call to protect Jesus' safety. And then number three, Joseph was called to protect Jesus' safety. Prophetically, he was called to protect Jesus prophetically. As we read the story in Matthew and in Luke, you'll see something like this. Matthew 1:22 says it this way: all of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. You see that over and over again. Joseph would do something, and it would say, this was done to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. Joseph may not even realize that his obedience to God, it was fulfilling what God had prophesied. The prophets had spoken in many ways about Jesus, his life, his raising, and Joseph was called to protect prophetically what God was doing. It's a very important calling upon Joseph's life. So the call came to Joseph, the call of Christmas to protect. But as we've been saying in this series, you know, the call of Christmas is not just about then, not just about back yonder. It's based upon then, the first Christmas, but the call of Christmas is also for us now, today. So let's just talk about how the call of Christmas, the call to protect, applies to us now. So on your outline, notice, we're called to protect. What are we called to protect? Number one, protect yourself from runaway emotions. Runaway emotions. There are many passages in the Scripture that tell us the importance of our emotions. Emotions in themselves are not bad, they're not wrong. But if our emotions are out of control, we are warned of the dangers of them running out of control. When our emotions are out of control, it can hinder us from making wise decisions. Our emotions, when they're out of control, can lead us into making bad decisions, doing things that are rash. It can cause us to live on the basis of our feelings rather on the basis of our faith. And just like with Joseph, the angel says, you must make sure you fear not, that you do not allow your emotions to control you, because if your emotions control you, you will not be allowing God to. So you must control your emotions so you'll be obedient to God. Think about your life right now. Are there any emotions going on in your life that are on the verge of being runaway? They're just on the verge of taking over your life, your thinking, where you're consumed about these emotions. It could be any number of things. It could be anger, it could be fear, it could be jealousy, it could be unforgiveness, on and on. All sorts of emotions, when they're left uncontrolled, can dominate our life, so we're not hearing God and being obedient to Him. I put on your outline Ephesians chapter 4, verse 23 and 24, where it says, be made new in the attitude of your mind, and put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. And then just a couple of verses later, it said, put off anger, put off jealousy, put off bitterness, put off unforgiveness, be like Christ, be Christ-like. So it says, control your emotions. We're not to live by feelings. We have feelings, they're part of our lives, but we're not to live by feelings, we're to live by faith. So when we're going through things, and during the holidays, many times there are many emotions that seek to control us, maybe dealing with people we're getting together with, or things that have happened in the past, a lot of those emotions, but we are not to live on the basis of the feelings, we're to live on the basis of faith. So in your outline, Romans 10, verse 17 says, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Joseph heard the word, he heard the message, when the angel spoke to him through a dream. He said, this is the word, take Mary as your wife, do not be afraid. And so he lived by faith, based on the word of God, rather than on his feelings and emotions. So we are called to protect ourselves from runaway emotions and acting on them, rather than the truth of God's word. And then secondly, protect yourself from temptations. Protect yourself from temptations. Oftentimes the Bible warns of this. One example is in Matthew chapter 26, verse 41 that I put on your outline. This is when Jesus was on the way to the cross, when he went through the Garden of Gethsemane. He was about to be crucified, and his disciples were with him, but they were wavering. They were physically tired, and Jesus told them in Matthew 26, verse 41, he said, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. He said, protect yourself. Watch, pray, that you do not fall into temptations. The call of Christmas is a call to protect ourselves from temptation. Now see, many times we put ourselves slap dab in the middle of temptations. We walk right into temptations that get us into trouble. And then sometimes we even magnify the temptations, we feed the temptations, and then we wonder why we ever gave in to the temptation. But we did things, we looked at things, we listened to things, we went places, we hung around people that increased the strength of the power of that temptation in our life, and then we say, well, I can't believe I fell to that. But then we just feed it. So we are to protect ourselves from temptation. And just think about this time of the year, there's always temptations, but at the holidays, in the Christmas, there's some particular temptations that seem to be very strong. Think of a few. Temptation to overspend. Temptation to spend what you don't have. Temptation for envy or jealousy. Man, they got that for, I can't believe they got that for Christmas. I want that for Christmas. You know, man, if I could get one of those cars like they got for Christmas, you go, wow. You know, we sometimes are envious or jealous, are greedy at Christmas. Give me more, give me more, give me more. So there's a temptation to overeat. Yes, I said it. Overeat, right? There's a temptation to overdrink. You know, there's a lot of parties, people serving this, serving that. And there's also a temptation at Christmas to participate in inappropriate sexual activity. During the holidays, many times people, there's this temptation to cast off restraints. You know, just have a good time, eat, drink, and be merry, you know, whatever. And many times people cast off restraints and they give themselves over to the temptation. So we are called to protect ourselves against temptation, particularly during the holidays. And then third, there's a call to protect ourselves from false doctrine. This is so common, particularly in the New Testament, where the scriptures tell us, protect yourself from false doctrine. I mean, of course, it makes sense because what we believe is so important to how we live in our lives. But it's, we're told this many, many times. One example is in 2 Peter 3, verse 17. It says, therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, it says, I'm warning you about this, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. To Him be glory now and forever. So be careful. Be careful that you're not led astray. You know, today when you look around us, there's false doctrine all around us. Many ways, many forms. Sometimes it comes from churches. We think they ought to be sound, but many are teaching false doctrine. It comes many times from pulpits under the disguise of truth. Sometimes it comes over the TV. Sometimes it comes from people we talk to, from our friends, will say things that are not true. It's just amazing how many times church people will say things that are directly contrary to the Scripture. They will believe things are okay with God, even though the Scripture clearly says those things are not okay with God. But yet, we're people around us say, well, yeah, that's okay. I mean, you know, say, you know, what's wrong with it? You know, and it's false doctrine. How do you recognize false doctrine? Primary way is by soaking yourself, saturating yourself in the truth of God's Word. So we're to protect ourselves from false doctrine. It's all around us, but we're to protect ourselves. And then on the back of your outline, the call to protect means you are to protect your heart. The heart represents the depth of your being. It represents your soul. It represents your affections, your love, the things that you value. And Proverbs 4 verse 23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from your heart, from who you are, the center of your being. You protect the things that you look at. You protect the things that you think about. You protect the things that you listen to. You protect your loves, the things that you value. You can direct the things that you value. You know, I think we live in a time where people are falling out of love with God. They're falling out of love with worship. They say, oh, yeah, you know, I believe in God, but, you know, I just don't love worshiping. I want to worship by myself. Or, you know, they don't love the body of Christ. People have fallen out of love. We're to protect our heart, the things we love, because it is the wellspring of everything. It directs what comes from our life. So protect your heart. And then last, protect your walk. Protect your walk or your obedience to God. Proverbs 4, verse 26 says, give careful thought to the path for your feet and be steadfast in all of your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. It says, watch your path. Protect your path. Protect how you live. Remember Joseph? The angel would tell him something, and he would do it. The angel said, Joseph, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. He took her. Then the angel told him, gave the warning, said, Herod wants to kill the baby Jesus. You need to go to Egypt. What did he do? He went to Egypt. Then a little later in the story, says the angel said, "Up, that one that wanted to kill Jesus, Herod, he's dead now. Y'all go back to Israel." What did he do? He went back to Israel. And then the angel came again and said, "Hey, you need to go back to Nazareth. You need to live there. Don't live here, but live there." What did he do? He obeyed. When he heard the Spirit speak, when he heard God speak to him, he protected his walk, his obedience, and he obeyed. The greatest thing we can do is to obey God, to do what he says, to protect our obedience. The most important thing is to walk in obedience to God, to protect it. And when we do, he blesses. He does things that we cannot imagine. He works through us to accomplish his purpose. Would you bow your heads this morning? As you think about your life, and I just want to ask you, have you ever received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Do you know that you are saved, that your sins are forgiven? Well, Christmas is about God sending Jesus to come to earth, to be born of a virgin, to live the perfect sinless life as the Son of God, to die on the cross for your sins, to be buried and to be raised from the dead, showing he is the victor over sin and death. And as you trust him, he saves you. Trust in him, believe upon him, and you'll be saved. Father God, I thank you that you love us so much. I thank you that Christmas is the testimony to the love of God for people like us. And I pray for some here today. I pray for some that are listening that have never received Jesus Christ. But I pray that today they would receive the great gift of salvation, that you would be Lord of their life, and that all of our days would be ordered by you so that we'd live in obedience to you. It's in the wonderful name of Christ we pray. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing our song of commitment this morning. And I hope you know him. Hope also that you are giving for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. This is a way that we give that allows us to communicate the gospel around the world and supporting our missionaries in other parts of the world. So I hope you are giving for that this Christmas season. And also know what the schedule is this week. It's a very important week. No services this Wednesday night. Saturday night, which is Christmas Eve, we'll have our Christmas Eve candlelight service at 6 p.m. It will be over in a little less than an hour because I know many people have activities, but if you have people coming in, it's a great time to bring them. It's a special, special service, Christmas Eve, 6 p.m., and then Christmas morning, 10 a.m. worship only, 10 a.m. worship only, and we'll make sure we're finished within an hour because I know many people have things going on also. But make sure Christ is at the center of your Christmas. Makes all the difference in the world. So glad you're here this morning. Let's sing our closing song.
sing with us.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Shepherds feared and trembled with low above the earth. Rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Sing with us, down in a lowly manger.
Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born.
Thank you for being with us this morning. We hope to see you Saturday night.